Amen. We'd like to welcome everyone today, and we hope everybody is doing well. It's good to have you folks on property, even though we're not in the building. I can't tell you what a blessing it is to see all the folks that have come out around our parking lot and listening on our FM receiver. And we're going to try this. Hopefully it'll work well and be a way for us to reach out to you. It was good to see you through your car windows and virtually handshake with you, and just such a blessing to see all these that are here today outside the building. And it may be a little different, but the Lord is still with us, and I believe He can use this for His honor and glory. What a beautiful Resurrection Sunday it is, and we're excited to be in the house of God. We want to welcome you. Thank you for coming. Those that are on Facebook, thank you for watching. And we hope something can be said today that will be a blessing to you. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer, ask Him to have His blessings on our service today. And then we'll sing a few songs, and then we'll try to share with you what the Lord has given us from His Word. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank You so much for Your goodness. Thank You for just allowing us to gather today. And Lord, just to see our folks, God, what a blessing it is to see them. It's been so long, and God, I thank You for just allowing this to work out, that we could gather together and worship You. And we know what You say, where two or three are gathered in Your name, You'd be in the midst. And Father, I feel You here this morning. Lord, I pray that You would be lifted up and magnified in this service, that anything that's done today would point to You and to no one else. I ask You, Father, if You would, to touch us as we open Your precious Word and we begin to read. God, I pray You would touch us as we preach. Be with us as we sing a few songs this morning to uplift Your name, as we are celebrating the day that You have risen from the grave, and we're so thankful for that. And Lord, I'm glad today that You're still saving souls, that You're still in the saving business. And Father, we do pray now that You'd help, You'd guide and direct. And Lord, I pray You would touch that one most in need. And it's in Your precious name we pray. Amen. All right. What are we going to do first?
He lives.
He lives. All right.
Thank you.
I'm glad that he's coming back to take us home one of these days, and we know that it won't be long. And as we look at the times that we're facing today as a nation, well, as a world, We understand that it's a difficult time, but I'm here to tell you today that it did not catch God off guard. He is not wringing his hands. He's not surprised by this. He knew that it was going to happen, and we've said that for the last two or three weeks. He knew it was going to happen, and he is in control, and everything that happens, happens for his will. We may not understand it, but we're not required to understand it. We're just required to trust him today, and I do hope that each and every one will trust him today. If you're not saved by God's grace, if you don't know him as your Lord and Savior, what a wonderful day that it would be to celebrate a new birth on Resurrection Sunday 2020. If you have your Bibles with you, I'd like for you to be turning to the book of Mark, chapter number 16. We're going to be looking at the resurrection just a little bit today with the Lord's help, looking at a few verses here, and hopefully it will be a help to you and a blessing some way. And please don't look at us. Please don't listen to us, but listen to God. That is the most important thing, that you would listen to him and that he would speak to your heart. I pray that you could just put away all your concerns for just a little while and just sit there and allow God to speak to your heart. I guess I'd be in the doghouse today if I didn't say this before we get into the message, but 23 years ago today, at this very church, I got to marry my bride, and we're having an anniversary today, and we're so thankful for the opportunity to, and I never dreamed it when we got married that God would put us here in this church to pastor. Brother Chris Goodman was pastoring here at the time, and he married us, and Wendy didn't sign up to be a pastor's wife, and I think she's made a good one. I'm thankful for her and how she pushes me, and she's definitely my better half, and I'm sure thankful for her. All right, if you have your Bibles with you and you've turned to Mark chapter number 16, we're going to read just a few verses here and try to share the thought as God has given it to us. In verse number 1, the Bible says, "And when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome had brought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him. And very early in the morning of the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. And they said among themselves, Who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulchre? And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. And entering into the sepulchre, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in long white garment. And they were affrighted. And he said unto them, Be not affrighted. Ye seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold the place where they laid him. But go your way and tell his disciples and Peter that he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him as he said unto you." Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your precious word. We thank you for your scriptures as we were able to read them this morning. Now, God, I pray that you would add your blessings to the reading of your word. Now, touch us, touch our hearts. God, I pray for all the folks that are listening this morning. God, that you would speak to them, that you would help them. And Father, help us today to be able to celebrate and enjoy the day that we have set aside for your resurrection. God, have your way in it. Lord, I pray that you would help that one that may be blind today that don't know you. God, would you speak to their heart through your scriptures? Now, Father, we love you. We thank you for what you've done for us, and it's in your name we pray. Amen. Now, as we look at this scripture this morning, a very familiar scripture, and normally, you know, if God will put it on my heart, I'll try to preach on certain holidays, and I want to preach this morning on the thoughts of the resurrection. But there was something in one of the verses of scripture that we read that really just stood out to me, and I think in the time that we are facing today, I think a lot of us have the same attitude as maybe these ladies had as they were on their way here. So we understand that Jesus, when he died here in verse number 1, we see that they're coming to anoint him with these sweet spices. And as if you think about that, a lot of folks think, well, they were coming to embalm him. That's not true. Joseph and Nicodemus had already embalmed our Savior, but this was just to further anoint the body of Jesus. And it was their way, basically, of showing their love for Jesus Christ. And I hope today we can show our love for Christ, whether we're here in the church house, whether we're outside in the parking lot, whether you're at work, wherever you may be. I think today that you need to be sure of yourself that you show the love of Christ. And when I say that, it's not a show for the brethren. It is a show for him, that he understands that that you love him. It's like showing love for your spouse and for your children. You don't have to jump up and down and hang all over them all the time to show them your love. That love should be something that is shown through an outward expression that we have sometimes. And we see that they had that desire, and they went to anoint him. And the Bible says in verse number 2, and it was very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. Now these ladies, they had no idea what had changed and how the world had changed. For 3 days and three nights, the Lord Jesus had laid here in this borrowed tomb, and that's why it was borrowed. He's not there anymore, but he laid there in that tomb, and the world went on just like nothing had happened, just like no one had died, no change had been made. People went about their business. They done everything. They worried about their problems. And here Jesus, the body of Jesus, is laying in the tomb, and he's laying there. A lot of folks think, well, he's dead and gone. The devil thought he was dead and gone. The devil was celebrating the death of Jesus Christ. But you know what? There was something going on behind the scenes as he was preaching to the Old Testament saints. And we realize he led captivity captive. We know all the things, how he defeated the devil and how he defeated death, hell, and the grave. But as the sun come up on this day, what had happened is there was a brand new, as one writer said, a brand new first day of a brand new week and a brand new age. And that's what was happening here. From now on, we understand that men would rest, not in the Sabbath, but in the Savior. I'm glad today that I have found rest in my Savior, as he says over here in Matthew chapter number 11 and verse number 12, or verse number 28. I'm sorry, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest. There's that word, rest in your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So we understand today, when Jesus Christ rose from the grave, we have a new day of rest. We can rest in him, and aren't you thankful for that? But as we get on down here in verse number 3 and 4, I want to share something with you as I've seen this. Now, we understand they were going with a mission to anoint the body of Christ. We understand that. We also understand that that was a custom that they were going to follow. So they went to follow the custom there. And as they get there, they're not thinking about the resurrection, even though the Lord had told them that he was going to rise again. He told them that he would die. He would go into the heart of the earth for 3 days and three nights, and he would rise again. We understand that, and I think they had put that to the side, and they wanted to make sure that his body was taken care of. Now, you know, I was thinking about this yesterday as his body lay there in that tomb. You know, you think about all the things that happen in death, and not being gross or not trying to be nasty in any way, but you think about how the flesh begins to rot and how it stinks and how the worms and flies may come. I believe with all my heart, as Christ laid there, his body was resistant to all those things. I believe that body laid there still. And as they wanted to come and they wanted to anoint that after the custom, they had forgotten about all the promises that he had made and all the things that he had told them that he was going to do there. So as we look at this, we get here in verse number 3, and they're talking among themselves. And the Bible says, and they said among themselves, Who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulcher? They were talking about that. They said, I know we want to go down there and we want to make sure that we can anoint the body of Christ, but who's going to roll the stone away for us? Who's going to make a way for us that we can get in there to him? They wasn't even thinking about what was about to happen. And in verse number 4, and the Bible says, and when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. They were excited when they thought, well, someone's already here. Someone has rolled the stone away. The things that had captivated them, the worry that they had as they went into that was who was going to move the stone, how it was going to be moved out of the way. Now, in the studies that I've done and reading and things, they say that this stone that covered the tomb was would roll from one place to the other, and it was in kind of a track, and that track would hold that stone in it. And that track was sloped, or it was just carved out in the rock, and it was sloped one way or the other. And they say that it was easier to close the tomb than it was to open it, because it sloped downhill to close the tomb, which would make sense to me. So naturally, these ladies were concerned about the massive boulder that they were going to have to move out of the way. And I can see that in their mindset. But everything had changed. Everything before them had changed. And God had already took care of the problem that they were concerned about. How many times in my life, folks, has God taken care of that problem that you face before you ever get there, before they ever got to the garden, before they ever left their home, before the spices were even purchased? You know what happened? God had already took care of that issue. He had rolled that stone back. He had moved it away. And because he had moved it away, we know that Jesus Christ had came forth as a resurrected Savior. But today, as I look at this, I want to ask you this question. I know things are tough right now and things are different. We've never faced anything like this. But don't you think that the good God of heaven already knows on the other side of this thing what's going to happen? Don't you think that he realizes and knows the heart of each of us? He knows what's going on. He knows our burdens. He knows our fears. He knows our trials. And I can assure you of one thing. He has taken care of it on the other side of this. Before this virus ever hit our nation, before a problem has ever hit your life, before heartache and difficulty has ever come, he has always been on the other side of it. He knows what it is that you need in your heart, and he will take care of it. Aren't you glad of that today? Boy, I am. I'm thankful for what he's done in my heart and for what he's done in my life and how that he's encouraged us along the way. There's been times in my life that I faced storms that I didn't think it was going to happen. And when I faced them, I didn't know how anybody was going to help them. But on this day, as they come down and they seen the stone as it was rolled to the side, oh my goodness, they rejoiced because somebody had done it. But little did they know. Little did they know who took care of the problem for us. You know, there's a lot of folks out there today that are good help. They're good at helping people. I'm thankful for our doctors and our nurses and folks that are in the hospitals, our EMT that are out here working. I'm thankful for them on the front lines, and they're helping to fight this thing. But you know what? I'm thankful for a risen Savior today that I can rest in. You know, it's amazing the peace that I have through this. If this is how God intends on me going, I'm at peace with that. If this is how God wants the church to be drawn closer together, I'm okay with that. If this is how God wants us to leave here, I'm okay with that. But you know what? He has a plan, just as this plan was carried forth this day. The Bible says in verse 4, and when they looked, they saw the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. They were excited because the burden that they carried or the problem that they had already been removed. But they didn't think it was God. They got on down there, and as their hearts were filled with wonder, they peeked in, and the Bible says, and entering the sepulcher, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment, and they were affrighted. They looked in and they seen this young man, and some people say it was John Mark, but I don't think it was John Mark. I believe this was an angel from heaven. You don't have to agree with me, but if it had been John Mark, they wouldn't have been frightened. They would have been amazed. They would have said, "Hey, John Mark, thank you for rolling the stone back. Here said a young man, and he saith unto them, be not affrighted. Ye seek Jesus of Nazareth." He knew what their business was when they come around the corner. "Ye seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold the place where they laid him." And I believe as they looked over there, an old cold slab there where the body of Jesus Christ laid, I believe there laid some old grave clothes that was soaked in ointment and anointing oil and things like that. And there they lay as a testament that he come through those things and how he was risen. And then they look over there to the side, and there was the napkin that covered the face of Jesus Christ, all folded up nice and neat. And if you know anything about Jewish customs, you'll understand that when folks were eating at a table, how they would let the staff or how they would let the servants know they were done. If they were done eating, they would wad the napkin up and lay it down in there, throw it down into the plate. But if they had left and they were coming back for more, they would take that napkin and they would fold it up nice and neatly and they would lay it there beside the plate. I'm glad today that the napkin was folded up there. Why? Because he was telling us, "I'm coming back. I'm not done. I'm on my way." I'm glad today through this trying time, I can look up and I can see him for who he is. He's coming back and he's not forsaking his children one time. What a blessing. As we look in the scriptures today, I'm glad, as he says in verse number 7, "But go your way. Tell his disciples and Peter that he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him. And as he said unto you. And they went out quickly and fled from the sepulchre, for they trembled, and they were amazed. Neither said they anything to any man, for they were afraid." You know, I think about this, the news that they'd gotten. And this is just my thinking, and I may be wrong here, but I wonder if this ain't the same little angel that appeared to them some 33 years earlier and said, "Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be unto all people. For unto you this day in the city of David is born a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." Hey, I'm glad today this same one, they'd forgotten about the good tidings that had been brought, but the good tiding that was told of 30-some years earlier was now at hand, and we serve today a risen Savior as the songs that was already sung. I'm glad that my Savior's risen. My Savior's not in the ground. He is alive and well, and he is sitting at the right hand of the Father, of the throne on high, and he's waiting to come back and to get his bride. Hey, he's not left us here to be in doubt and to be in worry. I think of these ladies on that morning as they go and they discover that their Savior is risen. As they come through, and "Mary, what are we going to do about that stone? Do you think the three of us can move that stone?" "No, I don't know if we can or not. Maybe we can. Maybe we can find some help." Now, I believe in my heart that they had not realized the guard had been put in place. I don't think they'd realized the seal that had been placed there. They went out of a good heart to show the love of Christ, but in that same motion, they were just wondering how they were going to get to him. You know what, today there's a lot of people that say, "How can I get to him?" You know, it is so simple to get to Christ. First of all, you've got to be drawn by the Spirit of God. You've got to realize that you are a sinner. Without realizing you're a sinner, you can't be saved. You can't be saved on your term and on your time. When God speaks to your heart, that is the time for you to come to know him. He died for you. He has risen for you. And he has made a way for you to go to heaven today. And my heart's desire is that you will put past the things and the obstacles that we see. They were going in their own way to worship. You know what, I look, and this is kind of an obstacle. As I look here, and here's my wife and my daughter and my two sons in this church that I'm used to seeing. Not only some of my best friends, but some of the people that I love so dear, like family. And God has put me as watch over them. And I know that you're here, and I know that you're hearing, and you're outside the building today. And it is a tremendous blessing. But you know, in a way, this has been a burden. This is some 5 weeks that we've not gathered together here in the house of God. And we look at this thing, and as we think, well, it's just aggravating. I'm sure a lot of folks think, well, this is silly. We're going to go to the church and sit there and listen out in our cars and try to get some help from the Lord. I felt the same way with Facebook and things like that. That's just not who I am. But I think what God is doing, and I've talked to several preachers this week, I think through this that God is getting a lot of us out of our comfort zones. So we've got a greater way and a greater avenue, and we will do our best to reach a lost and dying world. Hey, I don't look at this anymore. As we sit here and I hear your horns blowing, hey, I love it. That encourages me. That's almost as good as an amen, and I'm thankful for it. But you know, I look at this thing as it was such a burden, and how are we going to make it? And I've laid it awake at night, and I've labored over this for 5 weeks, and I think about how that it's just not going to be the same. But as I stand here this morning in the house of God with you folks gathered outside, you know what I'm feeling is a tremendous blessing of God, and God has allowed these things to go forward, and He's allowed these things to go on. So what I might have been looking at as a burden or as a trial or as a tribulation, you know what's happening from this? God is getting the glory, and He's opening a new avenue and a new door for the gospel to be sent around the world. And what a tremendous blessing it is today. I've never seen a time in my lifetime since I was a little kid that families are as close as they are right now. I understand. Hey, it's hard sometimes being cooped up in the house with all your family. I got a good friend of mine. He called me the other day, and he said, if somebody in my house dies, it ain't from the virus. Hey, and you know, I think about that a lot of times as we gather up, and how it is. Sometimes we get on one another's nerves, but isn't it a blessing to know today that we can gather together? And I see my family, we've probably sat down at the table more in these last 5 weeks than we have in a long time, or in a span of years. And we've sat there and we've eaten together and we've talked together. We're working on things at the house. We're doing projects and things like that to make the time pass. Families, I believe right now, are closer 5 weeks in to this than they were a week and than they were 6 months ago. We've gotten more time. I see folks that are reaching out. Hey, if there's ever been a time that we need to be more for one another instead of against one another, it's right now. Hey, there's too many bad things going on in the world for us to not gather together and bind together in prayer and encouragement of one another. And I encourage you today not to look at this as something that is in your way. They were looking at that stone as it was in the way. But God knew before this virus ever happened what was going to happen today. He knew from the foundation of the world we would be gathered here, my five in this church, and I don't know how many's outside, but there's a bunch of you. And God knew that. If you just clicked and watched this on Facebook, God knew that. Isn't that something? It's an avenue. God has a way. In His own way, we don't have to understand it. We don't have to agree with it. We just need to trust it. And I hope today you're trusting in Him. What a day. What a resurrection day. You know what? To be able to come to the house of God and to be able to gather with friends and family and loved ones, even though it's in a different capacity, what a blessing it is to be here today. And I trust and I hope that something was said this morning that'll help you, that'll bless you and encourage you, because we need that encouragement today. We love you. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for allowing us to gather today. Although it may be different than it's ever been, I'm so glad that you've made a way for us to be able to reach out to folks and to share the gospel. God, I pray that today as we sit down with our families here in a little while, Lord, that we could just appreciate the fact that you're not in the grave, that you're alive and well. God, I appreciate the fact that you reached down your hand and saved a teenage boy in an awkward time in his life when he didn't really understand things. But God, you showed your hand of mercy and hand of protection on me. Lord, I thank you for my family. I thank you for our church. I thank you for your precious word that we're able to open. Now, Lord, I pray that you'd put a hedge about our country, Lord, about our county or state, but Lord, about our church family. God, that you would put your hand of protection about us. Lord, I pray for the ones in the county that are sick from this. God, I pray that you would touch them. I pray that you would help them as only you can. And the ones around the world, Lord, I pray that you would show yourself in this, that you would get the praise and the honor and the glory out of everything that's done. Be with our doctors, nurses, law enforcement, EMT, everybody that's out there fighting for this. And now, Lord, I do thank you once again for just allowing us here today. I thank you for saving our soul. And it's in your precious name we pray. Amen. We thank you today. We appreciate you coming. We thank you for listening to us. We hope something was said that will be a blessing. And to those of you here at the church, if you want to, we may do this again on Wednesday night and pick up on our service that we've been doing, our study. I know it's a little different, a little hard, but most cars are more comfortable than a lot of living room recliners. So you can come and sit and enjoy the service maybe. We love you. We appreciate you. Thank you all so much for coming and making this special. I appreciate the horns blowing and egging me on. I heard them, and I appreciate that so much. And tremendous blessing. And we love you. We thank the Lord for you. We pray you all stay safe. Have a wonderful Resurrection Sunday. And we'll be talking to everybody soon.